this talk, I am going to report on some, essentially on these two papers, which were written with my master's student, Ramesh, who is going now to Amsterdam for his PhD. These two were written with a different master's student, Harsha Hampakura, who is in Brandeis now, doing his PhD, and one with Matthias. And then these are older papers from before some of you were born, I guess. and I think you know my co-author as well. And that's where this story started. So let me start with some motivation. So you know the point of the conformal bootstrap program, which I don't need to advertise here, is to get constraints on generic conformal field theories using generic properties of the symmetry and very little else. So crossing symmetry, for example, in two dimensions, angular invariance, are the kind of very strong constraints that allow us very little freedom in what we can have. Now, the current interest since the last many years is in CFTs that are related to ADS in some way. So there's an implicit, sometimes explicit, but always implicit sort of goal that, you know, we must, whatever we do, we must eventually take central charge to be large and have a sparse spectrum and have lots and lots of. So these are CFTs with lots of fields in them. And usually one can get constraints or bounds using bootstrap, modern bootstrap procedures like linear programming, these kind of functional methods, which semi-definite programming, which constrain what is allowed, but not very often allow you to actually construct a theory. In fact, I think it's still true that large C, CFT, there are not very many well-defined, explicit large C CFT at all. I mean, not even as well-defined as n equals 4 superangles in 4 dimensions. It's a very strange fact. Okay, so now here in this talk, we're at the opposite end of the spectrum. Instead of having many primary fields and large C, we try to study the space of rational CFT with a very small number of primary fields. However, it's interesting, I think, even for the large C problem, and once in a while, this, by the way, these can have large C. There's no obstacle to these theories having a large central charge, but they're not going to have a sparse spectrum. They barely have any spectrum at all. They just have like one primary field besides the identity. They're also rational, so they're not going to have chaos or Lyapunov exponent or anything like that. So they're not going to satisfy any conventional criteria for ADS CFT. That didn't stop, for example, Gabriel along with Alejandra and a bunch of other people from proposing a very quantum or very quantum or non-semi-classical ADS CFT dual from the Ising model to something which is not very clear. So you know, it's still interesting. And one more thing that's very interesting is that the extreme limit of these theories, that is theories with zero critical exponents, are the so-called meromorphic CFT. So zero. This is just, I guess, this is my word for something that you all know. These are called meromorphic CFT. And their key property is that the partition constant is just the mod square or something. And if you like, sometimes you can just say the partition function is this without its anti-holomorphic part, then you call it a chiral CFT. And these are very famous, and they keep sort of intersecting with stuff that people do in conformal bootstrap. For example, most recently these made an appearance in the paper of Rastelli, Hartmann and Mazach on sphere packing problems. So, you know, if zero critical exponent is interesting, one critical exponent should be interesting also, and actually more so because it could be related to statistical systems. That's always been one goal of CFT, and in fact from 1984 the minimal models were identified with some solid on solid integrable CFTs, and the early ones in the series were Ising pots, right, critical Ising and so on. Then of course
I realize this is highly unfashionable, but there's something called string theory, and when we study it, we need a worldsheet description. And for example, Gettner models was an example of the use of rational CFT to study string compact equations. I actually think that field isn't dead, though people don't work in it. Okay, then of course, ADS CFT, anyway, probably ID curve. Probably. And there's another interest which I hear various reviews about called topological quantum computing, and some of the results I'll mention have popped up in work of people who do this. So this is sort of anyon physics, and then somehow it interfaces with these things. Okay, so that's the bunch of motivations. I must say that in 1988, our motivation was indeed to understand string worksheets. But on the other hand, we never really got down to doing the supersymmetric version of what we did. So it's essentially wide open problem, generalizing whatever I'm going to tell you to the supersymmetric case. So I'll be assuming, so this is my Q with the 2, and the partition function of CFT, of course, is always the trace of this. I'll assume C is equal to C bar, and I'll assume that L0 has integer eigenvalues, so one fractional value and fractional value at the bottom of the tower and then one integer. So this is not a super conformal theory, and we know that the spectrum of a generic 2D CFT of this sort is primaries phi I, so just to set notation, the dimensions, the left and right dimensions would be that, and then secondaries, which I'm going to write as W minus N bar.
So you're assuming H I are integer?
No, H I will not be integer. H I will definitely not. So the primaries have some h, the secondaries have h plus m and h bar plus n bar, obviously from this formula. But the reason I've written w is that we're not going to specify what chiral algebra the theory has, we're going to discover that as an output. And this is a kind of orthogonal to the BPZ approach, which was first to decide a chiral algebra, which could be just the Virasoro algebra, or later in the work of Krishnik and Zamolod Chitrov, then it could be Katz-Moody algebra, and then later in when people did W algebras, well, it could be W3 or W4 or W infinity. But once you decide what it is, then you look for the null vectors of that algebra and find a minimal series. That minimal series usually has one nice attractive model at the beginning of it, one or two or three, and then it goes off into, you know, the number of characters, the primaries goes as like n squared in the series. And it's very uncommon. I bet none of you have ever worked with the 11th BPC minimal model explicitly. So here, instead, I'm going to allow for secondaries under any W, and the nice, which could be of spin 1, 2, 3, and so on. And the nice thing is then that you can have theories with small numbers of primary fields under this very large algebra, and then everything is much simpler. So I claim these are the simplest CFTs. So small number of I is simplest CFT. And again, this is not the number of Virasoro primaries, which is in fact going to be infinity essentially for almost all theories I consider, because they will be C greater than 1 theories, because C less than 1 is classified anyway. But they're still going to be simple because they have very few phi I. They will have descendants under a Katz-Moody algebra. Those descendants might be Virasoro primaries or not, but the point is that there'll just be a small number of basic fields. And then the number of critical exponents, so no phi I is the case of meromorphic CFT, and one phi is the case of one exponent, and I use this term interchangeably with the term two character, because if there's one phi, there's also the identity, so that's two primary fields, and there'll be a character for each of them under this extended algebra. Good. Please feel free to interrupt. Okay, now with this background.
Sorry.
Yes.
Do we have to think about this as like you pick one primary and then you adjust your symmetry in such a way that this is the only primary?
No, we just pick that there is one primary. We don't know what that primary is. We don't know its fusion rules. We don't know its dimension. So yeah, in some sense you're right. I mean, once I pick that there is one primary or there are two characters, I adjust. In that sense, it's a kind of like a programming problem. I vary some parameters till it clicks and there's a C. That's actually what we did in 1988. And I'll show you that briefly. So the constraint we're going to impose is, of course, that the full partition function is modular invariant. And that's all. That's essentially all that we're going to require. So this is a modular bootstrap. We're going to say these basic features and Z calculated by that is modular invariant. Okay. So as I said, you know that if I pick tau to be at the self-dual point and work around that, then Hilleman have these very nice bounds and so on and so forth. We don't do any of that. We simply assume full modular invariance, but we get out these simple theories. They're not so simple, and there are many, many more of them than anyone ever thought. So that's going to be the subject of this talk. Okay, I think I'll stick these other motivations. Let me just say one thing, this is a little tantalizing. If it's very simple and there are very few H's, it might happen, let's say there's just one H, it might happen that that H is greater than 1, just numerically. If it is, then the deformation of the theory by that primary, if it's left-right symmetric, will be an irrelevant deformation. So this theory will be more stable than anything else. And so sometimes some people in condensed matter, though I emphasize this is not very mainstream yet, call such CFTs perfect metals.
Perfect.
So this was actually first discussed in a paper of Chetan Nayak with Mulligan, who I guess is Kachru's former student. And Plamadeyala, who I don't know, this is 2014, and then it was popularized a little more by Sheehan in his paper, well-known paper.
How are they called?
Sorry?
Could you repeat the name?
The name of the people who...
Perfect metal.
Okay, let me write it. Another popular name is Dead End
CFTs. Oh, okay, good. Okay, I didn't know this
thing. greater than 1, not 0. Okay.
So this is fun, and we'll find some dead ends. I never heard this term. We'll find some dead ends in a few minutes. Okay. So what's really going to be our technology? So what we're not going to do is take tau to be real and expand around any self-real point. We're going to do instead, let me tell you the results because time could always run out. In these papers, we classified a special class of two-character CFTs, which I'll explain. In these papers, we extended it to a larger class. So long gap between these two and showed that this larger class really exists. And in these papers, which are most recent, we gave a complete classification of all two character CFTs. So complete classification procedure, which you can use to find every possible consistent set of partition functions with two characters and which are not invariant. So that's the
first. Are you going to assume unitarity?
So unitarity we are not going to assume, but in this talk probably I am going to assume because, so you'll see, I'll be showing you some tables which are actually on the other side of this board, and there are some stars and the stars are for non-unitary entries. So actually we encountered a lot of
interesting features involving non-unitary theories. One of which was that mathematicians now have a thing called intermediate vertex operator algebra, which is something which doesn't really satisfy, it has a degenerate identity character, so it's a bit weird. But it's something that we actually were the first to find which, in this paper. Of course, we rejected it, but mathematicians now have given it a name and it's something interesting. So I'll mention that. So yes, we do not assume unitary. Okay, so the key point now is that the partition function is going to be a sum of holomorphic characters squared. What I will assume is left-right symmetric theories, but we'll see that in another language these are also not left-right symmetric. It depends how you define the ties. But the point here is that it's a finite sum over these. This is what makes it a rational CFT. And P is the number of characters. I label them from 0 because 0 is the identity character, so it's distinguished. And then it goes up to P minus 1. Yes.
So is this an extra constraint on these theories?
Yes, it's a constraint because this is the constraint which will have, which will make it have one or two or three critical exponents.
No, that it's left, right,
so. I'm not sure. Actually, it is sort of a constraint, but what we'll find in the end are non-diagonal in a certain sense. I'll explain that. I think it'll become clearer as I show you. So therefore, now if P is 1, then it's the case I already told you, metamorphic. It's just the identity character. If P is 2, then it's chi bar 0, chi bar chi 0 plus chi bar 1. And this is the case of 2 characters. We've studied 2 and 3 character theories. In the literature, there is some study of 4 character theories. But 2 and 3 already have some very, very interesting features, and they have also featured in some recent works on numerical bootstrap, including works of the Korean group. J1 has been part of them, and a paper of Shi Yin, and again this paper of Hartman and Mazar-Chastelli and so on. So somehow they seem to, 2 and 3 character theories seem to furnish some kind of bound of the region in which all 2D CFTs exist. In a sense, that's not fully understood, but I'll show you some results which suggest that. Okay. So until now I haven't said what we're actually going to do to achieve, to implement the bootstrap. And so for now, just to be concrete, we'll always assume this. I should say, by the way, there could be an integer here, and this integer arises for different reasons. For example, if chi 1 corresponds to a complex primary, then phi bar has the same character, and therefore there's a 2 here. There's one very weird case, but it came up yesterday in Jacques' talk. If it's associated to D4, then chi 1 could be one of the 8s, 8c, 8v. All of them have the same character by triality, then there'll be a 3. This exhausts all possibilities. So this number here can be a 1, 2, or a 3. Let me put it anyway. It can also be 0, which is an interesting case. That's the case when you know that E8 has no primary field, so it actually E8 at level 1, M is 0. So it can be 0, 1, 2, or 3. Good. Okay. So
zero is the same as
metamorphic. And what will happen is that the metamorphic theories will keep popping up as special cases of these with m equals 0. Okay, so I didn't define the character, but the character is by definition the trace of all secondaries over a fixed primary q to the L0 minus. Again, I emphasize this is not necessarily a Virasoro character, it's the character of the full chiral algebra. Okay. And it takes the form q to the minus 4 plus d conformal dimension, and then a0i plus a1i q plus a1i squared plus all integer powers. And these are degeneracies of secondaries. And all these A.
You're not starting one?
If it's a primary that's not the identity, this doesn't have to be one.
There's a little bit of redundancy.
But there's not actually, and it's quite interesting. So if you're right in a way, the process we use to find these functions will be using a homogeneous equation, so we can never fix this constant.
Right.
Now, this constant will have to be fixed so that all the other constants are integers. And once we've done that, we may still have an m. The final coefficient of the power of q here will be m times a0 squared, and this is what you call the redundancy. It is there, but we can usually fix it. Good. Okay. Now the constraint is that a, m, I are non-negative integers. It's very easy to realize theories with or characters which do not, which are consistent with modular invariance, where the ans are not positive, need not even be rational, they could just be any real numbers. So in that sense, these kind of functions consistent with modular invariance are very general. And we have to search in that space for cases where a0, a1, a2 all are simultaneously non-negative.
So
it's like dialing something, and when it clicks, then it has a signal. Yes.
If you relax unitarity, you could allow for negative.
Yeah, so we actually, that's an interesting thing. I would not connect negativity of these with non-unitarity. I mean, there are well-known non-unitary theories where these are still positive.
Yes.
But we have now, so in the last two papers, we have proposed a category called quasi-characters, which are the same as these, but where A's can be negative, but still have to be integer. That actually gives us our complete classification, and you can use them. If you can use them for non-unitary CFT, that's fine. So we actually, that category is more general and actually much nicer. It's a intuition we missed completely for 3 decades, which is that if we just relax the sign, but we still, we still insist on them being integer, but just relax the sign, it's much more interesting, and there are many more solutions. Okay. Good. So now let's see what we want to do. So this is the constraint.
So I just use this stupid example of a theory which is non-unitary but has integer, but they give this exist in algebra.
Ah. Okay.
But it's goes by negative numbers because of stuff.
Ah, good. Okay, thanks. Thank you. So bosonic goes is right.
Even fermionics.
Yeah, so I mean, we're not discussing the fermionic case, otherwise these things would be indices or elliptic genus or lots of things. But in the bosonic case, right away, as you said, BC system can do that. Yeah, that's good. That's worth looking at.
Those would be fermionic in the sense that fermionic.
Yeah, anti-commuting, of course.
But they would still be integers.
That's right. Okay, so now let's look at the goal. Find all chi 0, chi 1 consistent with modular invariance of Z and AMI greater than or element of the non-negative. Sorry, there's some name. My student keeps scolding me for this. This includes 0, I hope. I think he says this is 0 and positive, no?
No, it's
positive. Because it's just the natural number.
Thank you. The student is smarter than me, so there is probably a Z star, but I probably just wrote it for the wrong. Okay, that's it. Okay, so how are we going to do this? Well, if Z is modular invariant, it follows that chi need not be modular invariant, but they should rather transform into themselves. So let me just write. So they transform as vectors. under a modular transformation. And then, since my original form of Z, I should keep it somewhere. With that, then this matrix, if it's unitary, will preserve this inner product, and Z will be modular. Now, if there's that one or that integer m which is 1 or 2 or 3, then this matrix may not have to be unitary, but it should preserve the matrix diagonal 1 and m. But that's the detail which is easy to take care of. So these things now are called vector value modular forms. I won't call them forms, they're actually functions because they have no weight. So if something is a modular form, you usually imagine there's a c tau plus d to a power in front of it, but these have no such power, and that's because you want z to be actually modular invariant. So this is the problem, this is the goal one. And goal two, which is, so goal one I claim we have sort of solved, and I'll tell you the solution in the course of this lecture. Goal two I'll refer to briefly, it's published in the second paper, and it is the question, find which of these is really a CFT. Now please don't take it seriously, I call this the swampland problem. So it's swampland because once you've solved the constraint of modular invariance and positivity, you have a wonderful pair of a wonderful partition function that satisfies everything that modular invariance and you know requirements of degeneracy being positive integer, all those things are satisfied. But who says it's really a CFT? And in fact, we'll see that the cases discovered in these papers all miraculously were CFTs once they had solved this problem. But in this paper we've shown that there are infinitely many cases which solve only this problem, but not necessarily this one. So we haven't shown it, but we've argued that. So solving this problem is harder and it's still unsolved. There's a little bit of a lesson for the Hellermannish bootstrap people, because you know once you get constraints on delta and bounds, crisp bounds, and so on and so forth, it's by no means guaranteed that there's really a theory there. If you've just satisfied modular invariance, that's still a little bit far from there being an actual conformal quantum field.
So could you give a definition of what to be really a CFT means?
Yeah, so good. So, well, Moore and Seiberg gave a bunch of criteria about four-point function, crossing symmetry, two-point function on the torus, and so on. So I think I'll go with that. But what's nice is that in many cases we can construct it somehow. If we construct it, then it's a CFT. Construct it in the sense, give you a procedure to calculate anything. So we can do that in some cases. Okay.
So how do you know that it's not a CFT?
Sorry?
How do you know that it's not a CFT?
I'll show you. I think it's better when I show you. Actually, this fact is known from the work of Sherikin's for metamorphic CFT, from work in 92. And I'll show you what the problem is. So I think it's easier to show you explicitly when something cannot be a CFT. Of course, they can always be loopholes or things one has missed, but by most common sense, at least many of them don't seem to be CFTs. Good. Okay. So let me actually do that right away. So for the one character case, meromorphic case, let me just remind you what's known. So chi has to be a function of j. Now, where j is the Klein invariant, q inverse plus 7.4 plus okay. So this is a wonderful function. This is the unique holomorphic function in moduli space, which has no poles anywhere in the interior, but it can have poles at the boundary as q goes to 0. In fact, it obviously does. That's the pole which caused it to be called meromorphic. This term is due to Peter Roder in the 80s. And these numbers are very significant. And the point is that this function is modular invariant and is holomorphic as well. Okay. And now, if I want my partition function z to be modulo invariant, where I just takes one value, so z is chi bar chi mod square, then the only solution is that chi should be a suitable function of j, and the only thing we need to tweak is that it should be a function which retains positivity of this series. So for example, j minus 1 million will not have a positive series because this term will change to 744 minus 1 million. You could also think of fractional powers of j, 1 over j, most of those will not have positive terms in the expansion, so that doesn't work. And the list of things which do work is quite amusing. So the first thing that works is j to the 1/3. So j has this interesting zero in the tau space, which is the torus moduli space. It has zeros at these corners. And because these corners are of order 1/3 or 1/6, depending how you count, so these are order 4 points of torus moduli space. So j to the 1/3 is very good. And its behavior is q to the minus 1/3 plus 248 plus everything else positive integer. And from this, you can read off that the central charge is 8 because the leading term has to be q to the minus c by 24. So minus 1/3. So c is 8. And this is a very well known and loved theory. This is DP8 at level 1 CFT. So this is the solution to the bootstrap for one character and the smallest possible simple charge. The next possibility is j to the 2/3, which has c equals 16. There's a unique character, which is j to the 2/3. So
you really mean q to the minus 3rd times 1 plus 2.
That's important, right? Because otherwise, to the second solution,
of course. It's all integer after the. Expansion.
You wrote it before.
Okay. J to the 2/3 has x equals 16. It's a single function. By the way, this, because of this fractional power, does have a phase under the tau plus tau goes to tau plus 1. But that isn't a problem if you want z to be mod chi squared. So we actually allow modulo invariance up to a phase. J to the 2/3 has this, but interestingly the two CFTs, and they correspond to the Katz-Moody algebra here. And I usually write SO32, but Jacques is in the audience, so and yeah, it's always fun to write this for the younger generation, and people are like, wow, what a coincidence, it looks like a heterotric string. It does not look like a heterotric string, it is why there is a heterotric string. It teaches us that there are two different CFTs for the same character, same partition function. It's the secondaries which have different fusion among themselves because they are descendants of different Katz-Moody algebras, and therefore how the correlation functions of secondaries are not the same. For these two theories.
It's the simplest counterexample of that you cannot hear the shape or not.
Yes. That's a good point. Thank you. Okay. Good. Now the next case is the one where all hell breaks loose, almost. And that is, so this is case 1, case 2. Case 3 is just J. Now you wouldn't be surprised if J 1/3 is E8, then the theory with J is just the CFT of E8 at level 1 cubed. There is such a CFT, there's no problem at all. But I'm free to add an integer here, and it's because J is modulo invariant. If I add an integer, it's still modulo invariant. And this sum now has just changed this number from 744 to 744 plus n. Okay? None of the other numbers changes. But the theory changes wildly over different n. So as n varies from, let's say, minus to plus infinity, you can have no theory, you can have a theory, you can have many theories with different current algebras, all these are possible. So first of all, I already told you that n better be greater than minus 744. Otherwise, this goes negative and it doesn't satisfy my definition of character. That's one step. Interestingly, if n is minus 744, then there is no current algebra. Okay, I should say, it should have been clear. If I have a character that has a leading term and then has a next term, this next term over the identity cannot be created by L minus 1, the Virasoro generator, because L minus 1 annihilates the identity. It cannot be created by any W minus 1 for spin 3 or higher, because all spin 2 and onwards, the minus 1 mode always annihilates the identity. But J minus 1, where J is a spin 1 current, that can create this. So this number is the number of generators of the Kac-Moody algebra, which is quite pretty. And now you can see, of course, this had 248 for E8, this one had 496, this one has 744 if it is not there. So we can read off the Kac-Moody algebra dimension just from that number. And the special case when n is minus 744 kills this term, and it's a very special CFT which has no descendant of the identity at first level. So there's no Kac-Moody algebra. But it's that's very much like a minimal model. So all minimal models have that feature. You know, there's no descendant of the identity at first level. This is also, you know, why, you know, the Virasoro characters are different for identity and non-identity. It's a null vector. L minus 1 on 0 is 0 is a null vector. But this is a theory with C equals 24, because it goes like J. These are the number of secondaries above a given primary under a generic chiral algebra. And what the chiral algebra is varies a lot. So I haven't shown you there's a theory yet. I'm just showing you this thing satisfies modular invariance at C equals 24 if you insist on one character. Now it's up to us to find sensible values of n such that there's a CFT. If I take the one-third power, yes, all these numbers magically, thank you, are exactly, which I presume Klein did not know when he proposed his invariant. So these are the beautiful connections that, you know, you take the one-third power and suddenly everything here is a representation of the
Is it
known
how to define and put the capacities of the
invariant? One can generalize this with fugacities, but I'm not sure if it's been done. Okay, we can talk about this in the afternoon. This is actually related to, there is some relation between what I do and Zagier's concept of theta decomposition of Jacobi forms. And somehow, at least in one case, that is related to putting fugacities. But that's SU2. Whether for E8 we can put fugacities in this way, I don't know. But we can really
level one current algebra, you can construct very, very explicitly.
Sure. Character formula tells you everything. Yeah. Whether it's known, you know, whether you can bring it out in this approach is less clear. But anyway, the goal is not to reproduce, I guess, things we know. but one can. You know, in the beginning, everything we found was a reproduction of things we knew, which actually was very, very discouraging. So after we wrote this paper, we were extremely discouraged. But I'll show you how things change along the way. So back to this. N is greater than this, and if n is minus 744, this isn't there. And now this is the character of a very famous CFT, it's called the monster CFT. And now 196884 decomposes as 1 plus 196883, and 196883 is the lowest dimension representation of the monster group, the largest sporadic finite group. But I emphasize, this number is always there in every CFT with this partition, with this character, and it doesn't usually have anything to do with the monster. It just has to do with the monster when n is minus 744, which is weird. Otherwise, it has to do with Kac-Moody algebras and many other things. Okay, so n has to satisfy this bound. Now, what about n being extremely large? Supposing n is plus a million, this looks fine, completely consistent with modular invariance, completely positive integer. So now I can answer Mario's question. The problem is that now if n is plus a million, then the Kac-Moody algebra has dimension a million and 744. So its Sugawara stress tensor has no chance to have central charge, only 24. So that naturally ends the story for large values of n. And Schellekens did this brilliant analysis in the range between minus 744 and plus about 50 or 100. and found 71 CFTs. So there are exactly 30 values of n allowed, and they lead to 71 distinct CFTs. This is in the same sense that here there is one character but two different CFTs. So here, often for some value of n, there are as many as 5 or 6 different CFTs. Okay? And that's all that's allowed in a space of infinitely many integers. Yes?
If n is negative 744, is it known that there's only one CFT?
No, that's a conjecture. So I keep getting scolded by everyone from Gabardiel to referees of every paper I write for saying this is a result. 70 of these are a result and one is a conjecture. Okay, by the way, so what was the inspiration for finding these CFTs? It will become relevant later. So there are these nice things called Niemeyer lattices in 24D. And there are exactly 24 of them. And these special lattices have, these are even and self-dual. And with one character, if it's even and self-dual and you compactify free bosons on that, it's automatically modulo invariant. So 24 of these theories were predictable before, were predicted and known much before Shelikhin's work. His work was to fill in the gap between the 24 known and everything, 71. So the extra ones are the ones he spent his time on. But it's nice that there are 24 such lattices. And each one of them is a Leech lattice, the others are less well known, but then there are just many, 24. And so he was able to look, so he was, now what can you do with a lattice? You can compactify free bosons, you get a CFT. You can also do some orbit folding of the lattice, and if you do it well, it will still be modular invariant and you'll get a different CFT. The monster is actually an orbit folder of one of these 24, the Leech lattice, you can orbit fold it. And then make sure that the twisted sector doesn't bring back everything you got rid of, it's a story, and then you get more CFTs. So this is how that works.
So in that case, I am sure you have already said that. So if you take J plus N, that will always be modular invariant.
Yes.
It will always have integer coefficients, but they are only 30 allowed because only 30 are CFTs.
Yes, because 30 are correspond to CFTs, and among those 30 describe 71 CFTs. Because some of them, for a fixed n, there's more than one.
And for that, you need to analyze four-point functions.
That's right. Or you define the CFT by its Katz-Moody algebra in some way. Yeah. Okay, so now the... this is not going very good in terms of time, but...
No, his example is the stress tensor, the Sugawara stress tensor, you're saying?
Sorry?
No, it's only the Sugawara. Is the stress tensor always Sugawara?
So I mean there is always a Virasoro algebra, right? So probably if you insist that the stress tensor is not, I don't know how to think.
Well, take the monster as the extreme example.
Yeah. It's not Sugawara, so
it's certainly not Sugawara.
That's correct. But I don't know any example where you can somehow, there are currents, but you can neglect them and just have a stress tensor that doesn't contain the bilinear. Mm-hmm.
Now that you cannot have both, but maybe you can have any.
Okay, this is going much slower than I thought, honestly, but it's fun. But still, let me just quickly, I haven't actually started on any of this. let me just quickly tell you that in C equals 32, you might like to repeat Shelikhin's work, and you might think that because we are in 32 dimensions, there are 32 self-dual lattices. That's a very poor physics argument. The number is 10 to the 10 of order.
In 16 you have 2, right?
It's true. In
16
you have
2
and...
In 16 you have 12, yeah, but it's still... See, 2 is of order 16. They're just small numbers. It's 1, 2... 1, 2, 24, 10 to the 10. That's the standard. Okay, so now I think without much ado, I can tell you what we actually did.
So actually, how was this counted? This was
sorry?
How was this 10% counted?
I think that many are actually constructed in some sense. I mean, there's a very nice paper by, I think, by King. I can show you, it's not just a paper, it's a web page in plain text. you know, mathematicians still use ASCII, and I just got pages and pages of details about these lattices. Wonderful. In ASCII, you can fit lots of, well, all right. Okay. So now, you know, one point that's crucial here is all this came out of holomorphy. It is because of holomorphy that the character had to be a function of J, and then everything else came from that. Okay? But we don't have a holomorphy of the partition function in two character case. We have characters which are holomorphic, but they are not modular embedded. So, sorry, I should have said, all this came from holomorphy and modular embeddings. And actually, conceptually, it's not much more than saying that the space of forms on a compact two-dimensional on a Riemann surface is finite, and you know them all, you know their poles and zeros, you have relations between them and so on. It basically uses that. Modular invariance is what makes it compact, because without that you'd be living in the upper half plane where there are less theorems, and holomorphy is important. Now the problem with this situation is that Z is certainly modular invariant but not holomorphic. The chi is holomorphic but not modular invariant. It's not modular invariant because under an S transformation it will go partly into that. It goes into a linear combination of chi 0 and chi 1 by a matrix, so it's vector value, so it's not holomorphic. So you cannot apply the kind of logic that we just applied either to Z or to chi. What we found is that chi I satisfy a modular invariant linear differential equation that is both holomorphic and, well, it's already modular. MLDE is the short form, and that is also holomorphic. So it's modular invariant and holomorphic at the same time. So we work with the equation rather than with chi itself. Okay, now why do I say that we satisfied such a differential equation? So there's a very pretty theorem. This is basically the concept of the Wronskian. Suppose first that I knew chi 0 and chi 1. And some function tau, chi of tau, is a linear combination of them. Then it follows that this determinant is 0. It's 0 by the fact that the last column is a linear combination of the first two. And this d is d by d tau on moduli space, though it's actually generalized to a covariant derivative, which is the so-called Ramanujan-Serre derivative. It won't be very important in explaining it, so let me just bypass that. So it's clear that this is true. But now if I expand this determinant by the last column, then I get the equation chi 0 and chi 1, then this is a differential equation satisfied by chi, and it's holomorphic as promised, because everything you see in it is holomorphic in tau, and it's modular invariant because chi 0 and chi 1 are assumed to be vector-valued modular functions, and that makes these three determinants all invariant, because the vector-valuedness just makes them linear combinations of each other, but determinants do not care about linear combinations. Okay? So in particular, this equation is satisfied by chi 0. If I would put chi equals chi 0 here, it would be true. If I put chi 1, it would be true. If I put any linear combination of chi 0 and chi 1, it's still true. Now, at this point, I got here assuming I knew chi 0 and chi 1, but obviously that's what I don't know. But the properties of this equation are that these functions are holomorphic and modular forms. And in fact, I know what sort of modular forms they are, because D, when it acts on any modular function, augments its modular weight by 2. That's an easy thing to check. People who work with modular forms know that. So this has things like chi 0, d, chi 1, so it has weight 2, this has weight 4, this has weight 6. So the modular weights are 2, 4, and 6.
So maybe this is the new development that generalizing the differential equations from the forms?
This is our discovery, and now mathematical, well, this is our discovery, that's a bit of an exaggeration. In the same year, Eguchi and Oguri and we wrote papers with the same differential equation but different goals. They observed that if you have a set of characters for a CFT, it satisfies an equation like this, basically like this. We observed that, the same thing, and that now if you forget that you knew the characters, you can use this equation to find the characters. And I'll explain that in a few minutes.
So was this
yes, actually, the mathematicians started working on this about 10 or 15 years ago, and
much after us.
And actually, even yesterday, I got a mail from Jeffrey Mason, who is a mathematician working in this field. So they keep saying that our paper was far ahead of its time, and that this is how we move the theory forward. It's very gratifying. And actually, I must say, you know, we didn't get very many citations in Spires for this paper, so I was very depressed for many years. Until I thought of looking on Google Scholar, and there it was all different, because Google Scholar gives lists the mathematics citations. So I advise all of you, you're feeling low, try Google Scholar. Google Scholar also gives wrong citations, so you might suddenly find a paper on sociology which has, you know, has given you many citations, but yeah, be careful. Yes, that's true. I think it is very true. And you should read Mason's papers, which we have referenced, because I think Mason and a lot of Japanese mathematicians, and Zagier, I think, Kaneko, Koike, Nagato, these are names, so they are mentioned in our papers.
But they have this minimum, Virasoro minimum, you did not know, for example, the characters of Virasoro minimum model.
That formula is known, that's the Roshakaliti formula. And I think Eguchi and Oguri were struck by the fact that if those characters are known, then they satisfy this differential equation. And for low values of the degree, you can use this to solve for the characters if you know C and H. Now the whole point is that we extended this to say we don't know anything, we just know there's a differential equation, and we have to proceed from that. So what's the differential equation? The differential equation is d squared chi plus phi 2 of tau d chi plus phi 4 of tau chi equals 0, where phi 2 is the ratio of this determinant over this one. I'm not going to write it again. And phi 4 is the ratio of this over this one. I simply divide the whole equation by this. This division has a very profound effect. So first of all, by dividing, it ends up that phi 2, which is the ratio of these two, has weight 4 minus 2, which is weight 2. That's why it has the subscript 2, so weight 2. And phi 4 has weight 4. One reason I restrict these talks to two character theories is you can easily generalize this to any character. There's nothing you cannot, you know, you just have to do this. It just becomes more tedious to write.
So I thought interested in the work of Zhu.
Zhu came much later. Dilin was later, Zhu was, I don't know when Svetanovich was, that I'll talk about later. We got a mail from him, we got a little he's right, and I'll come to that. But Zhu's work was much, much simpler.
And was he knew about your work? Because his approach is, of course, much more abstract.
His approach is more abstract, but he only gets a very, very small subset of our results for the following reason. Zhu's approach, just for you, leads to such a differential equation already in monic form. So
yes.
This is called monic form. But then, you see, phi 2 and phi 4 have to be holomorphic. But for us, phi 2 and phi 4 are the ratio of this over this, and this over this, and there's absolutely no reason why this cannot have zeros. In fact, generically it has zeros, and therefore phi 2 and phi 4 are generically not holomorphic. And I believe this is actually at the heart of a slight misunderstanding, because, you know, the first paper that Gabardiel wrote after Witten's proposal of extremal CFTs said that you cannot get such differential equations for those CFTs using Zhu's method. And Gayotto wrote a kind of reply paper saying, look, you're assuming that your differential equation is holomorphic in monic. So there was a bit of debate at that time, and I think that issue is not resolved. Anyway, so just to come back, phi 2 is weight 2, phi 4 is weight 4, but both are meromorphic because of zeros, possible zeros of this determinant, because they have that determinant in their denominator. Okay, so what's the number of such zeros? So in the old papers, we call this one W. These are all Wronskian determinants, W, W1, and W2. But this is the only one that goes in the denominator to get the equation in this form. And so it's only zeros of W that we're interested in. And this number is called L by 6. The reason is that it can be fractional. If the zeros of W occur here, then it's actually 1 by 3, so L is 2 if there's a 0 there. If it occurs here, then L is 3, that's a 0 of order half, because these are special points. If it occurs anywhere inside moduli space, then L is 6. For any, there are full zeros which can float, and then there are fractional zeros which are fixed at these points.
Can they be cancelled by zeros of W1 and 2?
Yeah, so somehow generically that doesn't happen. I mean, in special cases it could happen. So actually it might be safer to, instead of saying this is the number of zeros of W, I think actually they cannot be cancelled, but we'll discuss that. Right. But you could just say these are the poles of phi 2 and phi 4, then you should.
Well, it's maybe again an interesting result, because you're saying that the locations of the poles of phi 2 and phi 4 are the same. Which need not have been, yes. I mean, I could have considered equations where they have poles in different places.
Right. The locations are definitely the same, because that's the only denominator.
Right.
That's correct. Good. Okay. So now we realize, now one mistake we made in 1988 was not to give this number some sexy name, and so it's still called L, and this makes it very difficult. Like, you cannot have conversations about L unless the other person also knows what L is. So this is it, and this is very important. So L can be 0 and then 2, 3, 4, etc. Not 1, because as I said, this pole gives you 1 by 3. But this pole plus this pole, if they were both of them, you'd get 5 by 6. So that's allowed. So you basically, if you have two of these poles, you get 4 by 6. So these are the numbers. All. Now, in a site, in a related development, after we wrote this paper, Nakulich wrote a very nice paper in which he generalized our work and also showed that actually, just for two characters, the odd values are ruled out. So L is actually 0, 2, 4, 6. For this top, that will be the L odd values. For three character series, L could be any positive integer except.
Sorry, in the case that the zeros are not of an integer order, you will have a discontinuity as you go around the location.
No, you don't have, because moduli space has an odd default point there. That's why it's allowed to have that kind of zero. It's because when I go around the zero, there's an angle deficit and I end up here, and so basically the allowed zeros, allowed integral zeros, are fractional if they happen to be at an odd default point. Because the orbifold point counts them in the multiplicity automatically. It's part of the story. Okay, so good. I think I've reached a reasonable place. If you give me another 1 or 2 minutes. So now I can give you a kind of label of these papers. So these papers are about L equals 0 only. These papers are about L equals 2. And these papers are about L greater than or equal to 4. And until last year, it wasn't even clear there are any theories with L greater than or equal to 4. There were sort of statements in the literature which suggest that L equals 0 is the only thing. There was also a published paper soon after us proving that L equals 0 is the only allowed thing, but it turns out wrong. So the author was very annoyed. But
did that paper come down after 2016?
When we wrote this paper, he sent us an angry mail saying, what do you mean? I proved they don't exist. Oh, right. I said, here they are. Then we were a little nervous, but then when I went to ETH and we wrote this paper, we also constructed them so that there was no money question. And then we constructed all these, so now there's no question.
Sorry, so all of those is just for the two character things?
Yes. Exactly. Yes.
So you constructed the modular forms, you constructed the CFTs.
Ah, so good. So I'll come to that in a second, just a second. So, let me just very briefly tell you what the method is for L equals 0, then we can break for coffee. So for L equals 0, there's no phi 2, because there's no, so in that case, these are holomorphic, and there's no holomorphic modular form of weight 2. Under SL2Z, there is one of weight 4, it's called the Eisenstein series E4. So the differential equation is d squared plus mu E4 of tau. And now I think you can exactly see what we are going to do next. E4 is a fixed function, D is a fixed covariant derivative, which is this minus pi I by 12. So this is that. This is that connection on moduli space, the Ramanujan cell connection. And the only free parameter is mu, and it's a real number. But this equation is modular invariant and holomorphic for all mu. So for any mu, it's going to have two independent solutions, and we're going to write one of them as q to the minus c by 24, 1 plus da da da, and the other one as q to the minus c by 24 plus h, a0 in q series. Now we look at the q series term by term, and every coefficient is a function of mu. But there's only one mu, and there are infinitely many coefficients here and infinitely more here. So we look at the first few, and vary mu until one coefficient hits a positive integer. Now we are happy. We now throw away all other values of mu. Then we go to the next term and see if it's still, that's also an integer. That may cut out a few more. And by the time we reach the fifth or sixth term, it stabilizes. And then if you compute to 5,000 or 10,000 terms, they're all integers. And that's when it peaks. So that's the phenomenon. You dial only mu, and the solution just peaks. And okay, in those days, in 88, it took us like all day to do 100 terms using the software of those times. Mathematica, of course, can do 5,000 terms in a second. But now we can also, there are also ways to map these to hypergeometric functions, and you can actually show that it's no longer a conjecture. Also, Jeff Harvey, in a paper last year, pointed out, well, maybe it's known before, that like for modular forms, also for vector-valued modular forms, if you know that, it's integer up to some order, then you know that it's integer up to all other orders. So there are theorems like that. So it's sort of clear now, but it was very much an experimental method. So this was L equals 0, and I shall now the result is the left half of this. And we found exactly these solutions. And these are the central charges, so you see that they vary between 1 and 8. The star cases have some exception, which I have to explain. But the nice ones are 1, 2, 14 by 5, 4, 26 by 5, 6, 7, and 8. And these are the conformal dimensions, which are all very nice fractions, lying between 0 and 1. And these, A1, are the degeneracy of the first excited state above the identity, which is the dimension of the Kaczmundi algebra, and it's 38, 14, 28, 52, 78, 133, and 248.
This is precisely the Chaitanya sequence?
Yeah, well, it's, I think it's our sequence, but this is 1988 paper, it's actually published. Dillian discovered the same sequence in 1996.
Was before.
Yeah, so I don't know whether we were before the Chitanovich, but we were certainly before everyone else. So, I do want to point out there's a slight difference. I think Dillian and Chitanovich were just looking at the sequence of Lie algebras. This is a sequence of Kac-Moody algebras, follows Lie algebras. So, slightly different context. But yes, 1988, it's in the paper, and you can read it off because, you know, once you see these numbers, you realize what's going on. So these are all Vesuvino-Witten models at level 1. But they do include, importantly, the non-simply laced cases. And some cute things we found. With this case, the modular transformation matrix has a 0 in it. So that there are two characters, but the first character doesn't mix with the second. The second mixes with both, so it has one 0 in it, and that allows the first character to be modular invariant by itself up to a phase, and so that's the E8. And of course, once you have, you conjecture this, then of course we know the characters of these from the Kurzweil formula, and so you can easily check that what our differential equation gave us was the characters of these theories.
What is E7.5?
Ah, thank you. So, we rejected this theory because so there's a next step. I think I should do that after the tea break. Am I running a bit late? It has to. Well, I think I'm not going to explain all the start ones because I want to talk about the recent work. But privately, I can tell you it has to do with fusion rule, a fusion rules issue. Now it's called intermediate vertex operators by mathematicians. This and this. E7.5 was discovered as a missing element of the Dillian series by Landsberg and Manivel. And actually, Yuji Tachikawa told me this only 3 years ago. I didn't know at all. And I think even Masa Ito was there at the time. Yeah. So, anyway, so let's break for coffee and then I will tell you about all other L in one. So I'll resume. So this was the list of what we found by looking for L equals 0 to character theories. And there are some exotic features which I don't have time to talk about here. But we reproduced a bunch of theories that are well defined as an affine Kac-Moody theory at level 1. And so automatically when we solve problem 1, which is to find modular invariant partition function, we also solve problem 2, which is to find whether they describe a CFT. So there's a finite number and they all describe CFTs. As I said, there are a couple of exotic ones, but everything makes some kind of sense. Now, it was really Nakulich, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right.
Nakulich.
Who, soon after our paper, said, why don't I generalize this to L equals 2? And it's very simple. All you have to do is realize that there's one more term in the equation. And this term is E6 by E4. So previously there was no modular form of weight 2 which was holomorphic, but now L is 2, so we are allowed to divide by E4. E4 precisely has a 0 there. So if you divide anything by E4, it immediately has that equals 2. And since an E6 and E4 are, some people know, are the Eisenstein series of X6 and 4. So it's a very simple generalization of our equation. And he found a bunch of solutions with these central charges.
Why aren't there poles in the last term?
So there is nothing you can write with a pole in the last term. Because you could have E8 over E4, but E8 is E4 squared.
I see.
So it just turns out there's nothing you can write.
So that's the case in some sense where the poles do cancel.
Yes.
Yeah, E4 squared divided by E4.
Yes.
The poles cancel.
That's true. That's correct. That is correct. That's right. Thank you. So I think that's a better answer to that question. When they do cancel, you just have something holomorphic and deal with that. And of course, it's obvious that there's a finite dimensional space of, so these form a ring, and so there's always a finite dimensional space. So this equation for any L will have finitely many parameters. But if there are too many parameters, it's really not very helpful. So L equals 2 was doable, And as I said, he did it, and in our paper about 3 years ago, we repeated his analysis. So he did it, but he couldn't identify the result. He just found a bunch of central charges between 16 and 24, a bunch of H's, and these degeneracies, and none of these looks like the dimension of any sensible Kac-Mori algebra. So these are the first, so in the character expansion,
In
tilde is for this L equals 2 theories, or everything is tilde, and I'll explain why in a moment. I just put a tilde because there's a relation between them.
You added the column, the first column only one with the column for the CFTs.
Exactly. So actually, so when we redid his analysis, we started to guess what might be a reducible Kac-Mori algebra of these dimensions, and we wrote down a table with a series of guesses. We also verified his calculation was right to many higher orders and did a few more things. But honestly, the first paper we did on this didn't have very much more than Natsulich's own results. But then when I discussed this with Matthias, it became obvious that we also saw some regularity. You see, if you look at this range of values from 16 to 24, it's very similar to this range from 1 to 0 to 8, the same number of entries as well. What we didn't think of doing was to write this in decreasing order of central charge. And when you do that, you see that every entry adds the central charge C and C tilde add to 24, precisely. And that's true all the way down. And that's when we realized that actually these theories are all coset theories, which are obtained by taking a meromorphic CFT from Schellekens' table and dividing out by these theories. So all the L equals 2 theories are cosets of a meromorphic theory from Schellekens' table over a Bessel-Norwegian model at level 1. Now, the coset construction was known in CFT since a long time, but it was always of the form Bessel-Norwegian model, some particular one over another one. And if you look, open the yellow book, there's a long description of string functions and all kinds of things, which tell you how to divide one Bessel-Norwegian model by another, subtract the energy momentum tensors. But the Schellekens theories are meromorphic, they're one character, they are not Bessel-Norwegian models, but they do have Kac-Mori algebras, and they are reducible Kac-Mori algebras. So you can think of Schellekens' theories as a non-diagonal invariant, one in modular invariant, made by taking a sum of many Kac-Mori characters, and they occur miraculously. You would never find them by trying to write generic reducible Kac-Mori algebras and then add up characters to get one modular invariant. But you do find them by starting with holomorphian modular invariants. In the same spirit, the L equals 2 theories we found are all obtained by taking a Schellekens theory which has one of these as one of its components of its Kac-Mori algebra and then dividing by the corresponding Bessel-Norwegian model. Now if I divide, then a theory of C equals 24, which is all of Schellekens' theories, will lose this much from its central charge and this will be what's left. 24 minus that C is this C. So that works. More than that, I'll give you one example. Schellekens has one theory which has the algebra A11 to the 24. Okay. Now A11 to the 24 is SU2 at level 1, 24 copies. That obviously has central charge 24, but it has of order 2 to the 24 characters because you can multiply all the characters of each two character theory and you get it. Out of all those large number of characters, there's one linear combination which is modular invariant all by itself, and that's Schellekens' A11 to the 24 theory. Now if I coset it by A11, I'm left with a theory that has A11 to the 23, but it has two characters, and that's this theory. So this theory has the algebra, Kac-Mori algebra A11 to the 23, and that fits, but it has only one primary of dimension 7 by 4. A11 to the 23 will have primaries of all 1/4 dimension from 0 to 23 by 4, but this has only one. So it's a unique modulo invariant. And 69, which is this degeneracy of its Smoothy algebra, is 23 times 3, exactly as you'd expect. Okay? So one by one, we were able to show that every one of these can be obtained by taking a Schellekens theory and dividing out one of these. And also, Schellekens have multiple theories for the same partition function. That means in many of these lines, there are many theories. So I've given here Schellekens as table. So here's a periodic table. And 15 to 21, number 15, to, these are the serial numbers of Schellekens' table, which ends at 71. So theories 15 to 21 all have an A11 factor. And if you divide by that, then you get the partition function with n equals 2 that we found. All those six theories have the same partition function, and that's what they are. Now, amusingly, all the n equals 2 theories have h greater than 1, so they're all perfect metals in this sense, or dead end CFTs. They're not completely because they have Karsmoody algebra, so you can deform by j, or j plus j bar, or jj bar, which is marginal, but probably not integrably marginal. But certainly you cannot, if you deform by h plus h bar, then delta is greater than 2, so they are very stable. So these might be interesting.
And h plus h twiddle is 2?
Yeah, so they, exactly. So they pair up to give spin 2, and that's also nice, because the Schellekens theories have 196884 spin 2 fields. This is something you can read off from the J function. And some of them are spin 2 fields in this or this theory, but others are composites of the current of this theory and the current of this theory. So when H plus H twiddle adds up to 2, you get a new spin 2 field, which is a composite of the spin 2 field from this and that. So in fact, this brings me to a very important relation, which appears to have much more applicability than we originally thought. The coset property leads to a bilinear relation, which is chi0, chi0 twiddle plus chi1 twiddle is j plus n. So notice that this is a holomorphic, this is a completely holomorphic relation. Everything is a function of only tau. Chi0, chi1 are the characters of that. Chi0 twiddle and chi1 twiddle are the characters of these. And if I take this dot product, I get j plus n, where n is one of the values prescribed by Schellekens. And this is an alternative way of expressing the coset construction. What's really interesting is that a coset construction can only be defined when you have currents. So we found that this goes beyond theories with currents. This even exists in theories without Karsmoody currents. So for example, in one of our papers, we found a similar relation, but for three characters, where chi0, chi1, chi2 are the three characters of the IC model, and chi0 tilde, chi1 tilde, and chi2 tilde are the three characters of a theory with central charge 47 by 2, and of course IC model has central charge 1 by 2, so if you add these you get 24. And this theory with central charge 47 by 2 is known as the baby monster theory. So we sort of rediscovered the baby monster, which was already known in some sense, as a solution to three character differential equations in this way. And it satisfies again our bilinear relation. So this relation seems to have a life beyond what we originally expected. And in fact, there's a recent work of the Korean group, Kim Young and Sanjay, who was here, called Monster Anatomy, where they try to generalize this relation to find more interesting monstrous theories. So in this form, what happens is that the monster symmetry of this somehow is built up from theories which have lower discrete group symmetry. Yes.
So the degree of the differential equation is always 2, or does it go up?
Yeah, so these are of course third order differential equations. These are for third order. This talk is about second order differential equations. But you can have it, the degree is the number of characters. So the IC model satisfies degree 3, the POTS model satisfies degree 6, and so on, differential equations. It's just that it's most simple and interesting and analyzable when the degree is 2 or 3. Although, you know, one could have a clever idea for it. The problem is this involves tweaking something exact, there's nothing approximate in it. So you know, you have to think till you get exactly a valid character, and you can do that when the equation is second or third order quite easily. Okay, good. Now there's one relation that I should have written down earlier, which comes from the Riemann-Roch theorem. So in general, it is minus nc by 24 plus summation of all nhi is equal to, I always get the sign wrong, n minus 1 by 12 minus 10 over 6. This basically adds up poles and zeros over moduli space. This, if you see, if you realize, is the sum of all critical exponents of this form.
So what's n in this?
N is the number of characters.
Oh, number of characters.
Yeah. So for n equals 2, this equation is minus c by 12 plus h is 1 minus l by 6. So if l is 0, then minus c by 12 plus h must be 1 sixth, which you can easily verify for this pair of c and h. And when l is 2, then minus c by 12 plus h has to be minus 1 sixth, which you can also verify for this series. So that's one relation between c and h. And if you want, this is a little bit of a joke, I guess, I can rewrite this equation as h less than c by 12 plus 1 by 6 for l equals 0. And this, if I consider delta, which is twice h, then it's less than c by 6 plus 1 by 3. Now, this is a famous line in the numerical bootstrap. This is a bound of the central charges of low line theory. So this is for people who know this stuff. There's some line which they find which goes like that, and the equation is c by 6 plus 1 by 3. So they claim that CFTs can only exist here. This is a bound, and until central charge 4, sorry, have I done it the other way? 8. This is c. Until c equals 4, this is good. And then they seem to find a different bound, which is c by 8 plus 1 by 2. Interestingly, if you do this exercise for three character theories, that's exactly the equation you get. So there's some strange numerology, and I would love to know why it works. Okay. So 8 years after we wrote this paper, Deline wrote a paper showing that this is some particular series of Lie algebras with nice properties for their dimensions of their representations. Okay, so in the last 15 or 20 minutes, I'll summarize the recent work. I think it's actually quite easy to do. Any questions on this? So that's the complete story for L equals 0 and 2. I emphasize that for three characters, to my knowledge, not a single example of an L equals 2 theory is known. It's not a particularly hard problem. I think it's just that no one is working on it. So for three characters, the only thing known is L equals 0. And a month ago, there was a nice paper of Frank and Mason, who basically solved the MNS problem. These dimensions are not what we call dimensions. These dimensions are the number of characters. Three-dimensional vector value of modular forms. And the MMS problem is finding all L equals 0 CFTs. So there are infinitely many solutions. We have found actually most of them, I must say. But they, I think, made it complete and found all. So this is just L equals 0. Okay. So now the new work, interestingly, relies on an equation that you've already seen, which is the L equals 0, otherwise known as MMS equation. And from this equation, we pulled out only this finite set of consistent characters. But that's because we were fixated on solutions where the expansion coefficients are all non-negative integers. And it turns out, if you just relax the negativity requirement, then it has infinitely many solutions.
all the A and I tunes it, but not necessarily. But, and this fact was found by Kaneko and, well, it follows from a paper of Kaneko and Sakir. So this equation is now known as Kaneko's Sakir equation.
So you're insisting, find a pair of characters, K0, K1, or just
a pair? A pair, always a pair.
Always.
Yeah. And in fact, the interesting thing is that K0 has negative terms, K1 always turns out to be positive in the solutions. Now, it's very nice to relax positivity because, for example, if I have a positive series, power series in Q, and I take 1 by that series, I'll still get an integer series, but won't be positive. Okay? So, I mean, manipulations with these things, like multiplying them, dividing them, become... So the category, if you enlarge it to allow negative integers, it's much nicer. I mean, you know, the eta function, for example, you know, it's 1... Well, you have one product of 1 minus q to the n, so that has negative terms, 1 over that has positive terms, that's the partition function. So it's nice to look at things with negative terms. The theta functions have negative integers, yes.
What's it called, the Zagier equation?
Because Zagier is much more famous. I think they actually didn't know about our work. This is like about 15 or 20 years ago. But once they found out, they've been very nice and they keep referencing it.
I see.
My only little complaint is they only reference exactly one paper of ours in physics letters, but then they do a lot of details which are all in our next paper, and that paper they haven't actually read. So they're nice, they've been nice. No but you're right, you know, it is a fact. This is our equation, it's in our paper, and there's no dispute. Actually, again, Kaneko and Zagier, actually what they did was to, if you imagine multiplying this equation by some powers of eta, then chi will acquire a modulo weight. And they were actually looking at that equation, the version of this equation. So if you like, that equation maps to our equation by a trivial, simple transformation. So maybe it's not exactly. Anyway, what I'm telling you now is our interpretation of their results. And the results are of Kaneko, Koike, Nagatomo. There may be one or two names that I forget. There are several papers.
Does the value of mu have a significance?
The value of mu by itself doesn't seem to have any particular significance.
It's just a central charge.
Well, it's related to the central charge. Yeah. Okay, good. So, sorry. Thank you. I was about to answer that question and I just said it wasn't good. So, if I write mu as minus C into C plus 4 by 576, I'm free to parameterize mu in terms of some other variable, then this C turns out to be the central charge of the corresponding solution. Now there are two solutions, and one is the C in minus C by 24, the other is the one that gives minus C by 24 plus H. So this is a sensible thing to do. And now what you can do is put this into this equation, and what all these mathematicians showed is that there are four nice classes of C, which are of this form.
And can be negative.
It can, but there's a kind of inversion, so I think it's enough to have any positive. Again, because of this quadratic form, so I think the negative values are just the positive values by going to the other solution. So these are the four sets of C, which, and I'll label them by a class.
So I'm slightly confused. The actual value of C does enter into your solutions, though.
No, it's C and H.
Oh, C
so
and
this is
H.
One solution.
Yeah, no, you're right. C and H.
And the other solution is this.
That's right. So in that solution.
So what happens is
chi naught C appears, right?
Sorry?
Yeah, so in the first one, chi-naught.
Yes. Well, I don't know which one is which unless I insist on unitarity, which is lower. Now I'm not insisting on anything.
I see.
And the point is that there are two critical exponents, right. And if I chose two different solutions of this for a fixed mu, I would simply swap the solutions. Now, so the observation is that for these and only these and all these values of C, if I put this mu into that equation, I get integer solutions for all infinitely many of these. Okay? So, integer series solutions, which means all the A's in this series and all the A's in this series are integer, but not necessarily positive.
This is an if and only if?
Yes, it is an if.
And I didn't understand, the n positive or all n?
So, good. So just take, let's take n, let's take it positive, not non-negative integer. And if it is negative, what happens is that that's enough, so there's an infinite set of such c's for n positive, another infinite set for n negative, but again they just flip apart. So this c goes to minus 4 minus c. Is a symmetry of this parameterization and gives the same differential equation.
You see also
so it might be that n starts with, sorry?
I think you also want things with zero.
Zero. N needs to, so what is n? Sorry.
This is why I need a student around grade.
You put z greater than zero, yes.
Something. Very good. Now if you look at this, you'll see that as a special case of these, you find all these solutions. Okay, so c equals 1 is here, n equals 0, then c equals 2 is here with n equals 0, then c equals 14 by 5 is here with n equals some value, 1 I think, right? And then c equals 4 is again here, and c equals 26 by 5, 6, 7 are all, they're all here. And these are labels of what are called fusion classes, which label the fusion rules of the possible fusion rules of the associated CFT. And the nice thing is that for a very small set of n's, you get all of these. And those are the cases where these integer series solutions are actually positive. Okay? Once you relax positivity, n doesn't have to be confined in small values such that c lies between 0 and 8. And you have infinitely many solutions, and we call these solutions quasi-characters. So the feature of quasi-characters is they solve the same L equals 0, very simple differential equation. You know them explicitly. We can map this equation to a hypergeometric equation and find them as hypergeometric functions. And we know that they have all integer coefficients in their Q expansion. The question is, what use are they except the ones that already appear there? And that's the key result. So let's first give you an example of a quasi character so you sort of get a feeling for it. Supposing I take this series with n equals 4, so c equals 25, okay? Now there's clearly no theory in my left table over there with c equals 25, and the identity character is actually q to the minus 25 by 24, and then it starts nicely with 1, but it has minus 245 q, and after that it has it's just positive forever. It's just got one negative term. And basically what you find is if n, if n is 4 and c is 25, there's one negative term. If I shift n to something like whatever gives me c equals 49, n is 8, c is 49, I find two negative terms. They might be here and say here, but it sort of settles down to positive after some point. So it's negative terms are only early in the series. And only in chi1, chi0. Chi1 is positive. So a subset of these infinitely many quasi-characters returns characters, quasi-characters of this form, where chi0 has finitely many negative terms. I hope you hear what I mean by negative terms. There's a negative integer somewhere in the expansion. Finitely many and then all positive. Okay. So these we call type 1 quasi-characters. There's another type, which is quite amusing, where for n, for example, if it was say 6 or something, I would find that there are finitely many positive terms and then all are negative till infinity. Those are called type 2. I don't know what use to make of type 2. I'm going to make use only of type 1. So here's the simplest type 1 quasi-character. There are many more for all values of n up to infinity, but I have to take them in some multiples like 4, 8 or something. And then similarly in each of these series, you find sets of quasi-characters, all tabulated in our paper, which all have this form of finitely many negative terms, and then all positive, and chi1 is all positive. And now comes our proposal. Nicely timed with the bell. Is that my bell actually?
Yeah.
Okay, so now within a fusion class, one can add quasi characters. I shouldn't have rubbed out what I just rubbed out, but let me keep one example, 3, 4, 6, n plus 1. The claim is, if n is 0, which is c equals 1, or if n is 4, which is c equals 25, I'm allowed to add them, and this, because each of them has the same modular transformation, so does the sum. So it becomes a kind of integral space of linear combinations, all with the right modular transformations. And the beautiful thing is, I can add them in such a way that the minus sign gets destroyed and L jumps from 0 to 6 with every pair of terms I add. So I'll just demonstrate that for you, and that will sort of be the conclusion. There's a very nice example, and I think that will make everything clear. So the result would be an admissible character with L equals 6p. So if I add one pair of quasi-characters, L is 6. If I add three different quasi-characters, L is 12. If I add four of them, L is 18, and so on. So in this way, I generate all L's that are multiples of 6. And then we have a process to generate all L's which are 6n plus 2, 6p plus 2, and 6p plus 4. That completes all even L's. So let me show you why this phenomenon happens. I'm sure it can be given some elegant mathematical meaning, which we haven't yet done. But it's very pretty how it happens. Oh, I should say this concept, this idea was very much inspired by a paper of Jeff Harvey and Wu from last year. So I do recommend reading that paper.
So, I'm sorry, yeah. P plus 1 is the number of quasi-characters you're adding?
Yes,
okay.
That's it. P minus, P plus 1, yes. So here, let me give you an example of what I'm adding. So, so these are just leading terms I'm writing. So I take one pair of quasi-characters, which could be actual characters, having a certain value of C and H, then these are the leading behaviors. And the next pair I take has a C shifted by plus 24. So its leading power is this with a minus 1. Now once C is shifted, I just go back to the Riemann-Roch theorem, this one, shift C by 24, and I see immediately that H must shift by 2. To make this equation true. Everything is at L equals 0. And so it's minus C by 24 minus 1 plus H plus 2. So this is it. Now I make the linear combination. This plus an integer times this
And this plus an integer times this. Okay. Now let's examine what the values of C and H are for this linear combination. Clearly, the most negative power is still this. So I have the central charge C plus 24. Okay, which I read off from here because that's submitting. But here, to find H, I have to look at the lowest power, which is that. And this is minus C by 24 minus 1 plus H plus 1. So the value of H is H plus 1. So when I take a linear combination, C shifts by 24 and H shifts by 1. Put it in that equation and you find that L has gone to 6. So, as I said, I will probably, it's a little confusing, but what happens is when I add two sets of characters, the most singular behavior determines the central charge, but the conformal dimension is determined by the other character, and when you add it all up and use the Riemann-Roch theorem, you find that L is 6. So, this linear combination for all integers n has L equals 6. Okay, and in this way we have a table which I haven't given you, which shows that L equals 6 theories exist between central charge 24 and 32. Okay, in this example, say C would be 25 because I could start with C equals 1 and get 25. So this is the context of our paper curiosities above C equals 24, which is the second paper. Okay, so you get L equals 6 and you notice that n is an arbitrary integer, and we are now in the case of the Schellekens problem. This is the first time with two characters that there is an arbitrary integer and modulo invariance is fine. So now you have solved problem 1 but you have too many solutions. I should say that this is the first time, and really the first time was in Jeff's paper and not ours. Jeff's paper is from last summer. Where you could understand that there are infinitely many pairs of characters with any L as large as you like. Nobody had ever found anything like that before, other than tensor products, which of course you can always take and which is not exciting. So these are too many, and they have the same problem as Schellekens' theories, that for generic values of N, there's no reason to think there's a CFT. They just solve the modular invariance problem. And in our second paper, we used a very cute equation which is there, which comes from my earlier work with Gabardale on cosets. And that cute equation says that if I coset, this is the last thing I write, coset a meromorphic CFT with an L equals 0 CFT, then the coset has a value L tilde equals C by 2 minus 10. It's just some manipulation from the Riemann-Roch theorem, where C is the central charge of the meromorphic theory. So if C is 24, this is 12 minus 10, that's 2, that explains why these theories are L equals 2. But what if C is taken to be 32? Then of course L tilde is 6. So if I take any lattice CFT, meromorphic lattice CFT in 32, based on a 32 dimensional lattice, and quotient by any of these theories, I'll definitely get a theory, and it will be a theory with L equals 6, and it will fix the value of these n's in terms of the partition function of what's upstairs here. The downstairs ones are rigid. This one I have to look up from a table of lattices. Now there are 10 to the 10 lattices, and I honestly did not go through all of them, but luckily I don't need to, because there's a very special class in C equals 32 called curvware lattices. And these are lattices with complete group systems. And these are actually the only ones, and there are 132 of them. They're much better number to deal with. So for all these 132, we definitely have a C equals 32 CFT. We know it's chiral algebra. We seek among those chiral algebras whether any of these is present. If so, we divide by this and we get a theory with central charge 32 minus whatever we divided by. But since we divided by things which range between central charge 0 to 8, then the central charge of the coset is between 24 and 32. So that populates the range of 24 and 32. I emphasize all this with only two characters, so it's not
I mean, it's still a small result about very simple CFTs, but there are a lot of them. And so again, we expect that most of these ends will lie in some swampland of modular partition functions with no CFT. But we definitely could find some ends, and we wrote them down, which actually correspond to real closed set CFTs. So therefore, they do exist. And that's it. Thank you.
I have a. I didn't understand. Are you? Do you have a then a proof that all the L greater than or equal to four modular invariant partition functions are found in this way from these L equals zero quasi characters?
So okay. First of all, I didn't explain how to get 6p+2 and 6p+4. Mm-hmm. So for that, we have to construct quasi characters for 6p+4 L equals 2 and 4. Mm-hmm. Once we add those, then L keeps jumping by 6. That's just a rule of life. Mm-hmm. So if I have quasi-characters with, my quasi-characters here all had L equals 0. Mm-hmm. So they generated 6p. Right. If I have quasi-characters with L equals 2, they'll generate 6p+2. Likewise, 6p+4, that's done in our paper. That's what we call generalized Kaneko-Zagier equation, mm-hmm. and we did everything. Now the question I'm asking is this complete? Do we have all mm-hmm. quasi-characters? Mm-hmm. And we conjectured that, but last December at the Indian Strings meeting in Trivandrum, I talked about this. And Ashok Sen had a very interesting question, which was, supposing someone gave you a theory with some L, by subtracting a quasi-character from it, could you reduce L? And we realized immediately that's a proof of completeness. Because once we showed that, it's a very simple question. If someone gave me a valid quasi-character with L equals 12, then by subtracting my quasi-characters with some definite coefficient, I can reduce the L to 6. But that means that the L equals 12 theory is necessarily a linear combination. I can reduce L all the way to 0, and then I can by linear. So that proves completeness. So it's proved. So actually, this was a very valuable and short question, which is, as all who know Ashok Sen, this is what he does for a living. So really solved one of our most sticky problems, which was to prove this is complete. The quasi characters are complete because the mathematicians say so, and the generation of admissible characters is complete because of this proof.
So you are saying, for example, L equals to 2,
yes.
quasi characters are classified?
Yes. L equals 2 quasi characters were classified by us. Uh-huh. What we did was to simply take the Kaneko-Zagier approach and generalize. So, for example, if you remember in the A1 class, C was 6n+1 for the L equals 0 quasi characters, but for L equals 2 quasi characters, C is actually 6n-1. It's a different series, but it's easy to see how to make it. And interestingly, the L equals 0 and 2 quasi-characters all form coset pairs. This coset construction seems to just work for everything.
So you think like every partition function of, that is in the landscape and arises as a coset? You think that's the picture, or is it?
No, so yeah, so that's not clear, of course. But the coset gives us a way to, it's really very early days. We just found some 100 examples. It's nice to show that they exist, but that particular landscape problem is open, I think. We don't claim that they're all cosets. And also, even if they are
all... a single example which is not a coset.
No, that's true. Tensor products might be there. But one thing I should say is that we don't even know what are all the C equals 32 meromorphic theories. We're only focusing on 10 to the 10 lattice theories. But if some super Schellekens did the analysis on them, they would find at least 10 to the 10 orbifold theories for those 10 to the 10 lattice theories. So those can also be cosetted. So, and then there's an equivalent of the Leech. There's a Barnes wall lattice, which is like the Leech lattice. And it's a lot of fun. But it's a very, very big problem.
So yeah. All the L equals 0, 2, and 4 quasi-characters fall into these same kind of four fusion classes?
Yes, yes, absolutely. Fusion classes are fixed by having two characters. Actually, it's great fun. Once you know there are two characters, the only possibilities are phi is real and phi cross phi is 1, which is the A1 class, or phi is real and phi cross phi is 1+phi, which is the BN class. If phi is complex, then phi cross phi bar is 1, this is the A2 class. And finally, if phi is a triplet of 8s, 8c, and 8v, then phi I cross phi j is phi k. This is the default x. That's the theorem of Crist and Froom from the 80s, soon after William Day formula. And Mathur and Sen also have an independent paper on this. The fusion classes for 2 and 3 character theories are classified. It's very pretty. So yes, L equals 0 to 4, everything falls in the same fusion classes.
Just there is one comment. There is a other generalization we consider, which is also quasi, but in the sense of quasi modular.
Uh-huh.
So you can consider vector by quasi modular form, mm-hmm. which means you are log for log of Q.
Mm-hmm. Oh yes, good, thank you. So if you remember in my list, there were some exclusions. For example, I think I had, I don't know if anyone can tell me, 4n plus 2 with n not equal to 2 mod 3.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So supposing n is equal to 2 mod 3, not supposed to do it, but then I get 4 times 2 plus 2, that's 10, for example, and that is a logarithmic.
Yeah, you can just look at the initial question and see.
Yes, that exactly happens at these disallowed, so in my list.
But actually, not only those are, I dare say, are probably the most interesting.
The most interesting? Okay.
Because those are the ones that are related to four dimensional
games. Okay. Well, then let's talk about that. I think that is very interesting. I tried to look in the literature on logarithmic CFT, but this fact doesn't seem to be quite known.
But they're not necessarily very good. So the issue is that here you're looking at characters where you turn off to zero the verificacities.
Yes.
In a typical phenomenon that happens, and you have perfectly good representation of good characters, but in the limit in which you don't verificate, you get a singularity.
Okay, and it sums up to a lot?
And it sums up to a lot.
Wow, I had no idea. Okay. I should be reading your papers more carefully. I see. So that's what, then that, I think these theories are candidates. We have a short section on what the partition on the characters look like. So one is, you know, one is Q to the something, one plus etc. And the other is log Q plus. Yeah, should be done.